It's always nice when people clap, especially since I haven't done anything yet. It's fantastic. Hi, I'm Louis Marcassano. I am the curator of prints and drawings at the Getty Research Institute. And I'm here today to introduce the person that you really came to hear, Cornelia Funke. You know, at the Research Institute, we have collections of very old works of art, letters, books. And we organized an exhibition recently, just opened last week, so you'll be amongst the first to see it after the talk today, on printmaking in the age of Louis XIV. Can we have the first slide, please? And what you see here is an image of the king wearing this huge feathered helmet in the style of the Romans, but he's also wearing his very lovely cravat, his very lovely lace cravat. And he is here celebrating a recent military victory. In all the words that we see written here, this is over almost 350 years old, this print, and you'll see it in the exhibition. And all the texts that are written basically say, you know, Louis XIV is a great warrior, and we really need him. And then you see at the bottom the gods of war, Bellona and Mars. And the little thing that said, the little inscription there, it says, gods of war, don't be jealous of this great king. He can't help himself. He's a great military king. So these are the kinds of images that we'll be seeing today. Very, very, very serious. So if you're under the age of 15, you may or may not like this image, but I think you'll like the next one. It's a very serious image as well. And this is a woman spanking her husband because he's been out playing all night. So they did have a little bit of a sense of humor in the 17th century. This is over 300 years ago. So we will have an opportunity to go and look at this exhibition after the after Cornelia tells us her story, inspired by, you know, I love Cornelia, she's fantastic. She comes to the Getty, and then all of us who are very scholarly, we're very serious, and she gets us to look at the things in our collection that are in a wonderful imaginative way. So we can look at the past in a way that we haven't really thought of before with Cornelia's help. She's a huge fan of the Getty Research Institute, and I hope that you will be too. So let me just say a couple of things. Oh, happy Father's Day, by the way. How many fathers are here today? Oh, excellent. Happy Father's Day. Great, great. And so, kids, can you turn to your father and your mother and ask them to turn off their cell phones, please? That would be really good. Thank you very much for your help. I should turn mine off too, actually, right? Yes. So yes, yes. So let me just say a couple of things about Cornelia, and then we'll get to a couple of business items, and then we'll call her out. So Cornelia Funke, for those of you who don't know, is an award-winning author, best known for her popular series, The Inkworld Trilogy. Who's read that? Wow, okay. As well as The Thief Lord. Who's read that? Good. How about The Dragon Rider? Fantastic. And what about the most recent one, The Mirror Worlds? Okay, okay, that's very recent, but they'll be available after our lecture. She's going to be doing a book signing for a little while after the lecture. Okay, I've lost my space, my spot. Let me find it. Originally from Germany, Cornelia has lived in Los Angeles with her family for 10 years. Cornelia is a frequent visitor to the library at the Getty Research Institute, where she finds inspiring material about history, legends, and faraway places among its special collections. One character that has emerged from her research here is William Dampier, who is a pirate, adventurer, explorer, and ghost who lives in the vaults of the Getty and protects it from dangerous spirits. So Cornelia today is going to read us a story inspired by the exhibition and the vaults of the Getty. And so she'll be talking, she'll be reading the story for about 10 minutes, then she'll pause, she'll take some questions for a couple of questions for a few minutes, and then she'll start her story again. So remember, when she's reading, if you have questions, keep them in the back of your head and get ready. We'll pass you a microphone so that everyone can hear. So if you're kids right now, just tune out for a second. I've got some important business that we need. So we already did cell phones. There are going to be a number of tours of the exhibit just after the book, around the time of the book signing. And so you can sign up for those tours. There are a total of 4 tours, is that correct? Yes, not my collaborator and partner in crime, Krista Obi. Please stand up, Krista. That's her real hair. And also Cornelia and our designer, Amanda, they've made a little poster for you so that you can do a little bit of a scavenger hunt when you get into the exhibition. So you'll be able to, you'll be asked to look for different pictures of Louis XIV as a baby, as a warrior, as a dancer, as a man of fashion. So make sure you grab one of those posters before you go over to the exhibition. Okay, so there's always a lot of people to thank. I want to thank all of you individually, but I'll do that later. I'll offer you guys a drink at the coffee cart. But thank you guys for putting on this show. It takes a lot of people to get this thing organized. So right now, please join me in welcoming Cornelia Funke. Cornelia. She can't hear me. Can you guys help me call her, please? Okay, 1, 2, 3. Cornelia! Cornelia! Cornelia!
Relax. We decided we will always be dressed like this now. So first of all, welcome to the Getty on such a wonderful and sunny day. We feel very privileged that you nevertheless came in here. These stories that I tell about the Getty started about a year ago when Thomas Getkins, the head of the Getty Research Institute, had the idea that it would be great to do stories connected to the wonderful exhibits they do, that make them, open them up also for children and for teenagers and people who think this may be sometimes a little bit boring. As I know it's not, but you never know. So about a year ago, I wrote the very first story, and I read it here in the auditorium as well, and it was about the guardians of the White Fortress, as I call the Getty. And luckily, the curators call it like that as well by now. So the guardians of the Getty, as you can imagine, you've seen a lot of guards out there, human guards. Of course, we have those too. But as this is an institution where we have 8 vaults of treasure in this hill, which you all may not know, we need other guardians, a little bit stronger than human guardians. So I went in search of what kind of ghosts live at the Getty. And the most important one I found is William Dampier, as Louis Marquesano already mentioned, who in his lifetime, and you can look him up, was a pirate and an explorer and a very successful writer. I am actually not a pirate, but I think it's very interesting that you can have both professions. So Dampier is now a resident of the White Fortress, and he's guarding it along with a few other ghosts. So every new exhibit is quite a challenge, because you can imagine, with all the treasures coming in, hundreds of years old, many new ghosts come. And you have to make sure they obey the rules. You can imagine that if somebody like Louis XIV comes to the Getty, he's not very big at obeying rules. So I thought, let's write a story about that. So I will now read the first part, and as Louis Marquesano said, isn't it wonderful that he has the first name, the same first name, like the Sun King? So after 10 minutes, we will take a break and I will ask questions. I will ask questions. You will ask questions. I will try to answer them. It was very interesting. I have read to children all over the world, but many grown-ups have never had that experience that children do ask the best questions. I do know that. But every time I do an event, whether it's in India, in Australia, in Germany, or here, The first question afterwards is this. A grown-up comes to me. Cornelia, that kids ask such good questions. And I always say, yeah, they always do. So please don't let me down today, okay? Lots of grown-ups watching. And here comes the story. This is the notebook I wrote it into. As you see, I'm a very old person because I still write by hand. But I can only highly recommend it, and I know a lot of young writers who do the same by now. So this is a notebook with everything I had to learn about Louis XIV before I could write the story. And the story is, of course, called The Pirate and the King. The moon varnished the walls of the white fortress with layers of silver, and the hills stretched to the horizon like folds of black velvet. A perfect night for a ghost. And William Dampier, pirate, writer, and explorer in his lifetime, had been a ghost for 300 years. He was still surprised by how silently his boots stepped on the tiles as he walked down the dark corridors of the Getty Research Institute. A compass he owned as a living man had brought him to the White Fortress, high above the ocean he once sailed and plundered. And for the last 10 years of his ghostly existence, he had been the guardian of its treasures, hoping to make up for the years of robbery and greed. It had been an exciting day at the GRI. Just that morning, they had hung a new exhibit. The air was still heavy with the excitement of all the men and women who had worked on it for many months. Dampier could feel the anticipation as clearly as he used to feel the rolling waves under the planks of his ship as he passed the vitrines holding books more than 300 years old and the dozens of beautiful prints covering the smoke-blue walls. Most of the visitors would never know how much effort went into all this. So much work, passion, knowledge. A kingdom of images. William stopped in front of an especially beautiful print. This time, most of the treasure came from France, a place he remembered only vaguely from his lifetime. But a few of the other guardians came from there, the two sphinxes that looked after the North Pavilion, and the boy who guarded the West Wing. There were so many ghosts at the Getty. Of course, the whole hill was filled with memories, vaults guarding sketchbooks, photos, and writings of the dead. The print that had caught Dampier's attention showed the king who had inspired the exhibit, Louis XIV. Dampier looked at the labels. They shared the year of death, 1715. The old pirate didn't know much about the Sun King, as they had named Louis after his death. Dampier had spent most of his life far away from Europe, on the wild oceans of the New World. The eyes of the portrait met his, the gaze of one dead man at another. Dampier felt a shiver in his ghostly bones. There was something powerful in that gaze, so much ambition, such a strong wish to shine, to conquer, to rule. One of the curators had told him that Louis XIV had commissioned more than 300 self-portraits. There he was, as a Roman emperor. Another print showed him dancing. A dancer, a king, and a warrior. Quite a mix. And that palace he had built as big as a village and far away from Paris, had he really done it, as historians suspected, because he feared his nobles and his people, because that virtually imprisoned him and his mother as a child? The printed portrait didn't give the answer. All it revealed was pride and confidence. Maybe Louis had not only been a dancer and a warrior, but also a great actor. When a new exhibit opened, the guardians of the White Fortress were always on alert. Most exhibits brought at least one or two new ghosts. Louis himself hopefully slept calmly in his grave in faraway France, but maybe one of the brilliant artists would show up who had captured the Sun King's glory in this beautiful prince to make all of Europe bow in awe. Edelink, von Schuppen, their names were on the walls. Or what about one of Louis's many children? He had fathered more than 30, as far as Dampier recalled, and had survived many of them. Only his great-grandson had inherited the throne. And then there were all the women. One could cover a wall with their names. Yes, this king had had a great appetite for everything. Dampier walked back to the lobby, where the wallpaper of a 17th century fashion shop invited the visitors to travel back in time. To find what? The truth that not much had changed? Vanity was for sure not a trait mankind had overcome. The old pirate turned when a sharp bark came from outside. Coyote was standing in front of the glass doors, along with Silver Eyes and the Sphinxes from the North Pavilion. The moonlight gave away their lean silhouettes. Silver Eyes' bronze body was almost invisible in the night. Only his eyes gave him away. It was not a good sign that they were all here, especially as Coyote didn't like the Sphinxes. He never came to this part of the fortress. Coyote preferred the gardens, especially the cactus garden. He was much older than Dampier. He was older than the White Fortress itself, older even than the city, glimmering at its feet. Coyote was the spirit of the mountain on which the Getty had been built. He was sniffling the warm night air with a clearly annoyed expression on his furry face when Dampier stepped through the glass. Another advantage of being a ghost, no need for doors, elevators, stairs. "What's wrong, my old friend?" Dampier asked. "Another demon who crawled out of the medieval manuscripts?" "I wish," Coyote barked. "Give me dragons, demons. They are so much less annoying than humans, the most useless species on this planet, and so full of yourselves. But this one," he pointed his long nose to the dark buildings of the museum, "this one beats them all." "Oh no. What does he look like?" Dampier asked. "Quite pompous," Silver Eyes replied with his soft metallic voice. "His wig has more curls than a poodle." Silver Eyes had come to the Getty in a bust from Italy. "A poodle, he prances around on his high-heeled shoes like a pony who's been made the star in a circus," Coyote barked. The Sphinxes didn't say anything. They rarely did. They mostly just purred or snarled, although each of them carried the head of a woman on the body of a lioness. They led the way. The museum's dark entrance hall looked very different without all the visitors crowding it during the day, as did the long courtyard. And there he was, as Dampier had feared. The Sun King had come himself. Louis stood beside the great fountain, scrutinizing it with contempt. Then he looked with disgust at the buildings around him, so different from the palace he had built for himself. The King of France had not come alone. The ghost standing by his side was almost invisible, as if he wanted to make sure he didn't outshine his royal master. A musketeer. Dampier thought he looked quite glorious with the plumed hat and the high boots, although one could barely see him. He whispered something to his master when he saw the guardians approach, and Louis turned. The etchers had indeed captured him very well with their art. The gaze that met Dampier's was exactly the same as the one they had etched with their needles. Louis the 14th, the Sun King. Did he know he was dead? Some ghosts didn't. One probably should have bowed or curtsied, but Dampier had never been good at these gestures. Death hadn't changed that. In his lifetime, he had been court-martialed for treating an officer disrespectfully. He stopped 10 steps away from the ghost, who had once been one of the most powerful kings in human history, and bowed his head just a bit, the way he would pay his respect to any man. "Kneel!" the musketeer shouted. "All of you! Kneel in awe of the sun, or I, D'Artagnan, the king's musketeer, will teach you respect." Coyote uttered an amused bark. Silver Eyes pretended he hadn't heard. The sphinx's throat escaped a soft but slightly threatening purr. And William stayed as upright as he had stood on many ships in countless stormy nights. "Welcome to the White Fortress." His voice echoed through the silent yard as if a dozen dead men filled it with their breath. Dampier was glad he didn't have to try his bad French. Ghosts understood each other, whatever language they had once spoken. Death doesn't know about nations or kings and pirates. D'Artagnan grabbed the hilt of his sword, his face as white as a skull's bones, with the anger at such disrespect. Dampier wondered whether he knew that he was the hero of famous books and many movies. Louis raised his gloved hand, and the musketeer kept his sword in his teeth. Through his eyes betrayed a strong wish to cut them all into slices for their pride. "Where's your master?" Louis asked in a voice that had been taught to command since he uttered his first words. "Who is the king of this insultingly ugly fortress?" And he pointed at the lights of the city below. "Of these lands?" Dampier wondered whether Louis had more ghostly soldiers and servants at the building he usually haunted. Many of the works in the exhibition came from the Bibliothèque Nationale de France, once the palace of Cardinal Mazarin. Louis' teacher and father substitute, he had lost his father very young, though there were some doubts that Louis XIII had really been his father. Probably not a good thing to mention. "These lands don't have a king," Dampier replied. "They got rid of him quite a long time ago. The White Fortress belongs to the people, and we are its guardians." Louis's pale figure turned as red as if his body had been set on fire. Many ghosts turn fiery red when angered. The musketeer just glared at the guardians with such irritation that Dampier almost expected him to chew off his ghostly moustache. "Maybe I should get Zhong Zhang," Silver Eyes whispered. "I'm sure the Empress knows how to deal with kings." Zhong Zhang was the guardian of the South Pavilion and had come to the Getty in a vase. And she had ruled China along with her son and her grandson during her lifetime. Actually, almost at the same time as Louis had ruled France. "There is no right way to deal with kings," William whispered. "They are spoiled brats who have been told from the day they can crawl that they are gods and better than our kind. I fear death doesn't change that attitude." Louis was watching him like a cockroach who dared to have an argument in his royal presence. But he turned when a small figure came shuffling out of the South Pavilion. "I found just the right lodgings, almost Christian Majesty. They are perfect, as if they've been waiting for you. There is even a portrait of your Majesty." The ghost, who threw himself onto his knees in front of Louis, had a face as round-cheeked as an apple and a gray wig that was almost as curly as his king's. "I told you, O most glorious of all kings," he exclaimed, still on his knees. "This unexpected journey will freshen your spirits and lift your mood." "I guess he found the French furniture," Silver Eyes whispered. The museum was quite famous for its collection. "Well done, Baptiste," Louis signaled his servant to get up. "Show us the way. And you," he added with a wave of his hand in the direction of the guardians, "you are dismissed." The jeweled rings on his fingers shone in the moonlight as if he had caught a few stars. D'Artagnan, oh, what a name, Dampier wished he had been baptized with it, gave the guardians another frown and followed his king and Baptiste to the gate of the South Pavilion. First part ended. Do you already feel like questions, or should we continue? Let me see. Who wants to do questions? Who wants to continue? Okay, I guess you're more in the mood of listening. So shall I do that? Lot of questions? Oh, good. Then maybe I got the wrong spectrum. Here we go.
What is your favorite part of the Getty Center?
Ooh, good question. I am by now so at home at the GRI, I have to admit, but you know, they always show me their very secret treasures. You know, all the things they bring up from the vaults, like photo albums from the 19th century, when I can steal the stories of the dead. But I think it changes every time I come, because what I love about the Getty is that it has always new exhibits, and that they change all the time. And they have a size that I love. You go through it, you can even go through it again. And then, of course, I love very much the manuscripts.
Okay. I have one here. In your story...
Yes. What happened?
I'm sorry. When you said, like, he was patrolling, the ghost pilot was patrolling the Getty, and he was, like, trying to make up for all the years of robbery and greed, like, what made him change? Like, did something at the end of his life make him change, or is it, like, just,
I think that's a very interesting question. Thank you so much. It proves, once again, that children do the best questions, right? I think... What does change you when you've been a pirate all your life? William Dampier became quite a successful writer at some point, writing about his travels, and he was a very good cartographer. So he, for example, did famous maps of the Australian coast. And I think he got so respected and so loved by many people that he gave up the robbery and, in a way, enjoyed to be a very respectful writer. So he just continued that after death. Though I'm never sure, you know, I wonder whether sometimes he may go back to pirating. And I never told the Getty people, but I think it's a dangerous thing to have a guardian who's a pirate. So let's hope for the best, right? Maybe he's already building his secret chamber somewhere. And they think, why do all these things disappear?
How did they convince Louis to help them?
Where is the question? Oh, I'm with that. Yes. How do they convince Louis to help them?
Yeah.
How do you already know the ending of my story? That is very mysterious. Well, you know, in a way that will not convince him to help them, but you will see he will behave not very well, I have to say. So the second part will give you a glimpse at that. You know, and I had to, you know, when the curators first read it, they say to me, Cornelia, I'm not so sure, you know, there may be younger children, you should not have a musketeer, have a rifle. And I said, I know a lot about children, I think they will be fine with it, but we nevertheless mellowed it a little.
How many books have you written?
How many books are read? Oh, written. Well, that's an interesting question, because I think I've written by now 64, but there are only 24 translated into English, I think. The others are written in German, as I still do that, you hear my weird accent. And the interesting thing is, all my books are translated into Spanish. So if you can speak Spanish, you can read many more. And especially in South America and Mexico, I have such passionate fans that it is always quite wonderful. You know, it's the most exciting thing when you're a writer, you come to a country you have never visited and your characters are already there. I had that last year in Australia and in New Zealand. I walk into a theater and there are 2,000 people who all read my books. That was one of the best moments, I have to say. I could have dropped dead happy.
God,
Where's the next one?
How long did it take you to write one book?
Oh, that depends. For example, when I write a story like this, the most of the time that I need to invest is the research and the thinking about it. But then the story writes itself quite quickly. So I, for this, for example, I said it is about a month's work. When I write a book that is, let's say, for 8 years onwards, I just finished one. That takes me mostly with research about 8 months to a year. When I write for the older ones and the grown-ups, I often do so much research that it takes me 2 years. So I sometimes work on two at the same time, so that I do the serious one that takes 2 to 3 years. I have a break from time to time from that.
What gave you the idea of choosing the coyote as the spirit of the mountain?
Oh, another wonderful question. You are all fantastic, as I knew. You know, when I'm at the Getty, I'm always very impressed by the cactus garden. I don't know whether you like it as much as I do. And what I also think, and you know, maybe because I'm German, I'm very aware how wild Los Angeles is. For me, that is still magical about the city. You know, that we have the wild canyons and we're nevertheless a huge city, so we have it all. And as I have sometimes coyotes that I have to chase away from my dog running in Franklin Canyon or somewhere else, I thought, ooh, what was here before the Getty came? I'm sure there was a coyote. And as you know, in Native American fairy tales, the coyote is the trickster and a very powerful person. So I thought there needs to be somebody like that who reminds us of the past and the past of this place and of the ground. So, and here was Coyote. And he walked into my story as if he had always been there. Thank you.
So why does the musketeer still serve the king?
Because also a very good question. Well, you know, I just read a book about Louis XIV and how he imprisoned one of his best friends for life. That friend died in a prison, in a dungeon, a Monsieur Fouquet. And I read that the musketeer D'Artagnan arrested him, whereas the musketeer Aramis, whom everybody knows who read the Dumas stories, did help Fouquet. So the three musketeers that we know from movies and were historical characters. And one of them, D'Artagnan, saved Louis XIV all his life. So I thought, it sounds like that kind of relationship that will last through death. And that's why he's still by his side.
Why was he a ghost?
Why was he a ghost? Because he lived more than 300 years ago. So I think, you know, I think sometimes some of us may have unfinished business and become ghosts. I've heard from many serious people that they have seen ghosts. Sadly, I have never seen one, but maybe one day. So if I come often enough to the Getty, or maybe at night, I still have a chance. I even have the plan to be locked into Salisbury Cathedral, which is a very old church in England, next year at night, to finally see one. And they allowed it to me. They already said it's fine. But I'm not allowed to be alone, which may ruin it.
Why did Louis turn red?
Well, you know, I thought while I was writing about them, normally when you write and somebody goes angry, you say he was pale with anger. And I thought, wait a moment, Cornelia. When a ghost gets angry, do they get more pale? I don't think so. So I thought, maybe they get fiery, you know, like a red light of anger. And that's why I made him turn red.
What is your favorite book that you read?
Oh, this is always one of the most tricky questions I can be asked. Because you have to imagine all my books are now listening. You know, and they are like jealous children. So the moment I pick one, the others get angry with me. But I would say mostly it's the one I'm working on. And at the moment, it's a book called A Griffin's Feather. And it's the second adventure of Dragon Rider. a book I wrote many, many years ago. So I am in the middle of the Indonesian jungle at the moment, and my heroes have just been trapped in cages by the griffins. So I'm having enormous fun.
This is a weird question, but why did that Louis guy, you know, the guy, his name Louis, why did he imprison his best friend for life?
Sorry, why did he?
Why did he imprison his best friend?
Yeah, well, that's not a weird question. That's a very good question. Because when you read about this king, Louis XIV, it's very interesting. I think he was a very cruel and a very kind man at the same time. So I think he imprisoned his friend, whose name was Fouquet, because he was at his castle and Fouquet had given an incredibly beautiful party. And Louis was famous all over Europe for his parties. And I think that king was jealous that his friend was outshining him and became very nervous. And that's why he made up an accusation against him and had him imprisoned. And I think that for no man in the world, it is a good thing when you can do whatever you want to do. And Louis could do whatever he wanted to do. So imagine you ever in your life have a friend you get angry with, and you are a king as powerful as he was. We all cannot be sure what we would do. Because I think when you get power that big and everybody tells you you're like a god, you also become cruel. And Fouquet died in prison. But thank you for that question. That's a very good question. So just a question about time. Do we need to do the reading again, or how are we time-wise? One more question.
What was your inspiration for Dustfinger from Inkheart?
Thank you very much. That is, you know, sometimes a writer dreams of creating a character that has so many people who love him, and Dustfinger is one of them. When I started to write Inkheart, I always saw a character in my head, and I did not really know who he was, who was a little shady, and he had some creature with him, an animal, but I did not know what that was. I often see things before I write about them, like almost an image in my head. And one night, I went to a market in Germany that was like a medieval market, so they pretended we're in the Middle Ages. And there were fire eaters on the stage from France. And I thought, oh, that's what Dustfinger is. He's a fire eater. And then the whole character came together. But I never fully know where they come from. Okay, shall we do the next chapter, and then we get back to the questions? So, Louis and the Musketeer and Baptiste have just disappeared into the South Pavilion. If you meet them there at some point, please let me know. The king and his musketeer left a scent of a sickly sweet perfume behind. It was clearly true that the use of perfume had been excessive at Louis' palace because it had smelled worse than a public restroom. "Permission to chase him," Coyote barked. "Him and his pompous little soldier. Oh, I can't wait to bite a piece out of their perfumed..." "No," Dampier interrupted, though he would have loved to watch Coyote do exactly what he intended to do. "They are guests, and we should try to keep them in a good mood until the king leaves again." "Which will be how long?" Coyote barked. "Don't these exhibits run for several months?" "That sounds like an awfully long time to me. Just a little bite. Come on." "The captain is right," Dampier heard the worry in Silver Eyes' voice, although his bronze face never gave away such emotion. "This king is a warrior, and so is that musketeer. Louis XIV led armies into battles. He commanded sieges and ordered massacres. He had one of his closest friends left to rot to his death in a dungeon. How do you know all that? Dampier asked. Servais shrugged his shoulders. There are lots of books in this fortress. And the sphinxes like stories about kings. The sphinxes confirmed with a purr. Find Jojong, Dampier said. We need to make sure our royal guest obeys the rules. Maybe the empress doesn't know how to deal with kings. I admit, I just want to kill him. The south pavilion was Jojong's domain anyway. They all glanced at the sky. Dawn was casting a pale veil onto the night. Soon the first tram would make its way up the hill, filled with visitors from all over the world. Dampier sighed. They could only hope that the Empress would convince the Sun King to obey the rules, especially the most important one, to stay invisible. While the Sphinxes went in search of the Empress, Dampier walked back to the GRI. For a moment, he longed for a ship under his feet, sailing for unknown horizons without a worry about dead kings. It was not always easy to be a guardian of the White Fortress. Dampier had dealt with dead thieves and forgers, with demons emerging from illuminated parchment, and a dragon that had crawled out of a vase. But this king was a challenge of a different kind. Oh, to hell with them, or wherever it was where dead kings went. Dampier decided to forget about Louis, not easy, as the GRI welcomed him with his portrait, and to distract himself with the wonderful old maps that were kept safe in the vaults beneath. Some he had drawn himself, when he still had hands made from flesh and blood. Dampier spent a few blissful hours unrolling maps decorated with the drawings of dragons and great krakens, showing the vast lands of China and Australia. But suddenly, he heard the rustling of silk behind him. Captain, how could you allow this usurper into my quarters? A small figure took shape between the white metal drawers that protected the treasures of the past from light and dust. The Dowager Empress Chaozhong was, as always, clad in the most precious silk gown, embroidered with Chinese birds and flowers. Her hair was covered with ghostly white pearls, but her face, usually at least as white as those pearls, was a pinkish red, and her soot-black brows drew lines of anger onto her porcelain skin. I wish I could summon my armies. He does not even have the decency to make himself invisible. On the contrary, he prances around like a peacock and... Jojong felt silent and looked at Dampier in alarm. Yes, he heard it too. Ghosts can hear sounds that are dozens of miles away, and what both he and the Empress heard was indeed alarming. Hundreds of voices shouting and screaming, running feet. Oh, no! No! The daylight made Dampier's skin itch as he stepped outside. High above the museum, Louis hung in the sky, so huge that the sun seemed to be just a pearl in his ear. His lips were curled in a very pleased smile. He clearly enjoyed the sight of the fleeing crowd running towards the stairs that led down to the tram. The musketeer was standing on the south pavilion's roof, motionless, like a servant who has chased a deer in front of his master's rifle. The blue sky was showing through his ghostly silhouette. Oh, this was bad. This was very bad. Silver Eyes was already at the stairs, helping the human guards to catch stumbling old ladies and panicked children. Luckily, the guardians could see each other even when they made themselves invisible for the living. Dampier cursed Louis and all kings in general while he rushed to Silver Eyes' aid. The Empress and the Sphinxes tried to make sure no one was pushed in front of the tram, and many others had come to help. There was the boy who guarded the Western Pavilion. He had come in a drawing. And there was the ghost of the opera singer who lived in a chandelier, which was formed like a gondola. And the illuminator who had come with a French manuscript. ghosts of men, women, children, wild beasts, dozens of invisible hands helped the living gods to calm the crowds. But it felt like herding sheep back into their safe corrals. Coyote had alarmed the scientists at the Conservation Institute. Most visitors didn't even notice the building high above the tram station where men and women searched for recipes to preserve the treasures of the past. They all worked very closely with the guardians. When the stampede of visitors flooded into the tram, they were welcomed by a scent of lavender and a foggy hint of lilac smoke. After the ghost of a Dutch painter had caused 300 people to swear that the Getty was haunted, its scientists had developed a benevolent gas that both calmed the senses and erases all memories of ghosts and other unusual sightings. So far, it had been used only twice, but it once again proved to be very efficient. When the tram reached the foot of the hill and the visitors stepped out, there was no hint of panic. Dampier and Silver Eyes overheard some conversations to make sure, but the only complaints were about the lines at the cafeteria. No mention of a king's ghost smiling down from the sky, or of a musketeer drawing a sword. A scent of lavender had erased those memories very sufficiently, but it couldn't calm Dampier's anger. Where was the crown? Here we are again. So before we follow the pirate teaching a king some manners, I thought we'd do some more questions if you want to. Are there more questions? Yes, there are. So let's do that. You see, you don't disappoint me. Wonderful questions. All the grown-ups are in awe.
Why did the pirate want to become a writer, not like a thief or a guy who like steals things off of ships?
Yeah, you know, for a while, I think that is fun to be a pirate, but it's also a very dangerous business. And I think maybe one robbery went wrong, and then maybe he did feel older. And then maybe there were more ships that were guarded by military ships, which happened at some point. So once the pirates got a little bit too busy, both the English and the Spanish always guarded their richest ships with military ships, and it became quite a risky business to be a pirate. Mostly you ended up with a rope around your neck. So I think that William at some point said, oh, maybe, you know, I've been a pirate, I did that, so maybe I write about my adventures and make money with that. It's safer, you know. I have never been threatened to be executed. So that may be the reason.
What's your favorite part of your favorite book that you wrote?
Oh, once again, the difficult question. Well, you know, the thing is, I have in every book a little bit of favorite glimpses. So, for example, in Dragon Rider, I have a favorite character who is called Twiglek, and it's a homunculus born in a bottle made by an alchemist. And he's about this size. And he's quite a liar and a traitor, but he turns at some point. I like that moment very much. And then I just wrote three books about a world behind a mirror. And I still love that moment when my hero for the first time presses his hand on the glass and goes through. Who is next?
Who is your favorite ghost?
Oh, that's also a good one. Well, that's difficult though. You know, I like Dampier very much, but I like Silver Eyes too. And I think I will come up with many more ghosts because I'm supposed to write 7 stories. You know, so I'm just done with 2. So, you know, it's so tempting to find more ghosts at the Gettys. So maybe I answer that question in a few years when I'm done with all my stories.
Why did he curse him?
Why does he curse him?
Yeah.
What do you, don't you think that if you were the guardian of this fortress and suddenly a ghost shows up and tries to command you around and do whatever he wants, you would curse him? Because you were a pirate, so you're a wild man anyway. Right? So I think you would. And don't we always curse people from time to time, although we don't really want the curses to become true? Just secretly? No, you never do that? You're a much better person than I am. You know? You see, that's the thing about writers. When you hear their stories, you learn a lot about them. So I admit from time to time, I would have cursed him, though I would not have believed that the curse come true. I would have just sworn a lot, which I'm not allowed to do in this story. Does that answer the question? Thank you for the question.
And the pictures on the board, do you know when they were taken?
Sorry?
The pictures on the board, do you know when they were taken?
Oh, no, I don't know, because those are pictures from the Getty. So we always do it like this. I write the story, and then the Getty people put a lot of images together so that you at least get glimpses of what I'm talking about and where you can find things. Do you think you are on that image?
So why is it that in the stories they some of the characters threaten to like do things to each other, but they're already dead?
Yeah, very good point. And I think we should point that out to them. But I think, you know, when you're dead, you still like to threaten, and you really just like, and you will see, you know, they will do things to each other later on. Mm-hmm. And then you will learn what ghosts can do to each other. But as you say, it's quite harmless compared to what we can do to each other. So if, of course, we do believe we become ghosts, then, you know, we can't do very much to each other anyway, you know? Who is next?
What was your favorite book that you wrote?
Oh, here comes the question again. It's your favorite one this day, today. First of all, it's always the one that I just finished. But if I have to say, of all the books that I ever wrote, probably the book I just published in Germany is my favorite, and it's called The Golden Yarn. But there's a problem with that one. Because my English readers and my American readers were waiting for that book, but my American publishers wanted me to change the first chapter because they thought it's not good for the American readers. Whereas the Germans, the French, and the Spanish like it very much. So I did not change the chapter. So now I have no American publisher at the moment. So I have to do that probably now myself. So that's why this book, which is my favorite, is not yet in English. And Cornelia will publish for the first time in her life herself.
What made you want to start writing?
I was a very bored illustrator. So I was an illustrator, and I got texts from publishing houses, and I thought, oh no, again, just two children talking on a schoolyard, three children sitting in a kitchen. I want to draw dragons. I want to do mermaids. So one night I sat down and I wrote a story, and I put everything in that I love to wanted to draw. And that book, I sold it to a publisher. So I still did not notice that I became a writer. So I was continuing as an illustrator who thought she only writes to be an illustrator. And it took me 5 or 6 years until I realized that I take the writing as serious as the illustrating, but I still do the illustrations for my own books myself.
Are you going to make a book of it?
Of
a
this
movie
one?
Of it?
You know, what we hope is that when we've done 7 stories, we will do 7 small books that will be like in a box almost, and you can have it in the Getty shop. But we're still thinking about that because, you know, the stories are quite short and it's not easy to make them into a book. They are already online and you can read them online, but it would be beautiful to have them on paper, especially at a place like this where there are so many beautiful things.
old were you when you wrote your first book?
I was incredibly old for your standards. I was already 28. So what you learn from that is, take your time with choosing what you want to be one day. I did many things in my life, and I tried many things, and they all come together now in the most wonderful way. But I started to be a writer quite late. And now I've done it a long time.
What's your favorite book, and who's your favorite author?
Oh, there are two books I love very, very much. The one is The Once and Future King by T.H. White. That's an English book, and it's about King Arthur. The other book is The Princess Bride by William Goldman. And those two books I would take to the Lonely Island if I were allowed to have two books.
If the coyote ever ate a ghost, wouldn't it still be alive?
I admit he did. The coyote especially likes to tear pieces of a ghost because it grows back. So when you are a very not well-behaving ghost here at the Getty, and a coyote comes for you, he may tear off an arm, but then your arm grows back because you're a ghost. But very good question. And coyote is very pleased right now. You know, I hear him purring.
What's your favorite character from all the books you wrote?
Oh, that is also a difficult one. Okay. I hope the others are not listening, okay? First of all, it is Twigleg, the little homunculus from Dragon Rider. Even my company is even called Twigleg because I like him so much. Then there is in the Thief Lord a boy called Prosper who looks after his little brother when his mother dies. He's one of my other favorites. And then there is a girl who's also a fox in my MirrorWorld books, and she is who I would like to be in my books.
Do you think, since you told William Dampier's story, you could be charged with piracy?
Ah, yeah, that is of course true. I did not think about that.
What was your influence like? Did anyone in your life influence you to become a writer?
I think every writer I loved as a child. You know, I grew up in a very boring little town in Germany. I thought it was very boring and not very pretty. And I always thought as a child, the world must be more adventurous than this. So the library was my rescue. So you should have seen me. I came out of the library with piles of books. I was a book eater because the books with a promise that the world is more adventurous than this little town. And so I think each of the writers I read at that time influenced me vastly.
Okay, so I was wondering if your German books still sell in America.
My German books still sell in America?
The books are written in German?
Yes.
Do they sell here?
They do, but you know, most of my most famous books are translated into English.
Okay.
But by now, I know that it's tricky to get them. Of course, there are some bookstores here in America that, you know, sell German books. Mm-hmm. But I know it is not that easy. And I was very glad that Random House, for example, just did a few of my smaller titles and published them in English, because it's often so sad when you meet parents, for example, and they say, Cornelia, why don't you write for 6 and 7 year olds? And I say, yes, I did, but it's not translated.
Okay.
So it's getting better, but I think in general, it is not so easy to track them down.
Okay.
And most people here, you know, who read me even think I write in English, which I do by now. The short stories I do write in English. So where are we time-wise? Two more questions.
What's your favorite part of the book?
Which one?
The one you're reading.
That's not a book. It's a story.
Oh.
So, with such a short story, it's quite difficult to say, well, what is your favorite part? You know, because it is almost like a beautiful little thing. So I would say I just love to write these stories for the Getty. They are always my special treat. But I could not say I have a special part in it, a favorite part. Now?
Last one.
Did you have any people in your life that you based characters off of?
Which is always a very good question. First of all, to all of what you ever want to write, there's a warning. Don't use your family and friends. They may recognize who they are, and you cannot just show their nice sides, because otherwise it will be a very two-dimensional character. So I try to not do it too often, but my son loves to be in my books, so he was the model for several characters, and he likes that, even with the dark sides. My daughter likes to get dedications for Anna. That's what she likes. And then I sometimes just take glimpses of people and put them in a character. But I also once, for example, I wrote a book called The Ghost Knight, about a knight in Salzburg Cathedral, the ghost I still like to meet. And I based the female heroine on a friend's daughter because she was so perfect. And I asked her for permission. She read the book. And my British publisher called me and said, "Oh God, Cornelia, how did you come up with that girl? Such a great character." I said, "Yeah, I cannot take the credit. I just stole her." So sometimes I do that by now. I also based some characters on actors. And I love to, by now, base characters on the photo of somebody from the 19th century whom I don't know anything about. So here at the Getty, I found many characters. But just looking at old photo album and saying, "I think you're a man-eater. I think you are a child-eating witch. I think you were quite an explorer behind the mirrors." And then I take the faces and I make them into new stories. And I hope they don't mind. So, shall we finish the story? And then whatever questions you still have, we see. Okay. Where was the crowned fool? Neither Louis nor his musketeer were anywhere to be seen, but Coyote found their track in front of the South Pavilion. Dampier's ghostly silhouette turned a purple red when he stepped through the walls. The Empress was so upset that she dissolved into 1,000 pieces that followed Dampier and the others like a swarm of fireflies. Even Silver Eyes gazed at the world with red instead of silver pupils. And the fur of Coyote and the Sphinxes stood up like hedgehog spikes. In contrast, the ghost who had caused all this was in the best of possible moods. Louis was where he always used to receive guests and petitioners during his lifetime, in bed. The four-poster bed in the South Pavilion has curtains of blue silk and ostrich feathers on their poles, and like Louis, it comes from France, though from slightly younger times. The king had also grown younger. Ghosts can choose their shape from all the ones they wore in life, and Louis celebrated his successful haunting of the Getty in the shape of a 13-year-old boy, the age at which he had been crowned. "Ah, mon Dieu, that was more satisfying than hunting stags," he exclaimed when Dampier stopped in front of the bed. In contrast to his king, D'Artagnan looked slightly older, as if he hadn't enjoyed the prank half as much as his royal master. He was standing guard next to the bed, while Baptiste was cleaning away a set of porcelain plates that Dampier suspected to come from one of the museum's vitrines. The Empress was still assembling her pieces. She was so far only a gown and two eyes looking very angry. "Did you see them run?" Louis threw one of the silken pillows at Baptiste, but his servant seemed to be used to such attacks and ducked in time. "I haven't enjoyed myself that brilliantly since a party I gave more than 300 years ago. We had fireworks for 4 nights in a row. Do you remember, D'Artagnan? Oh yes, the garden caught fire, and you and your men were covered in soot the next morning. Louis jumped off the bed with a laugh and walked past the guardians to the huge mirror hanging to the left of the bed. He tried to see himself in it, but ghosts are invisible in most mirrors. The boy king frowned and turned his back on the empty glass. I own 413 beds in Versailles, he announced. But even the most expensive one had bed bugs. He pointed at the four-poster bed. This one doesn't. How do you manage to get rid of them? I should have brought some. Dampier replied angrily. Their bites are quite painful, even for ghosts. Though I admit I'm even more tempted to ask one of the dragons from the manuscripts in the North Pavilion to bite your head off. Louis gave Dampier a mocking smile and stopped D'Artagnan once again when he reached for his sword. I like you, he said softly. I think I'll have you executed, but I do like you. I always preferred men like you to all those blue-blooded snobs who thought they'd make a better king than me. Nobody ever was a better king than Louis XIV. Nobody ever played that part as well as I did. Zhang Zhong had finally managed to put all her pieces back in the right place. Liar! She screamed. Who wants a king who spends his people's bread on wars and parties and on a tasteless palace in a swamp? This time D'Artagnan did draw his sword. But Zhang Zhong's ghost grew until her black hair touched the ceiling. You are a guest of this fortress, she boomed. And even kings have to honor the rules of the host. There are no rules for the sun, Louis shouted back while he grew as well until he faced the empress under the ceiling. Baptiste hid under the bed with the porcelain, which Dampier found very thoughtful. My mother dressed my brother like a girl, Louis mocked, pointing at the empress's gowns, to make him as soft as a woman, so he would never challenge me. That was too much for Zhao Zhong, who had been stronger than many men in her lifetime. She burst into pieces again, that burned into Louis's ghostly shape like the fireworks he had loved so much. D'Artagnan tried to fight them off with his sword, but all he managed to do was pierce the bed's silken curtains and crush a very precious vase. Enough! Dampier barked. Enough, all of you! Zhao Zhong took the shape of the Chinese sign for rage, but she withdrew, and Louis shrunk back to the size of a boy. We can do this all night, he growled. We can do this for centuries, but in the end, this fortress is mine. I have conquered cities and countries. I have ruled for almost 70 years. I survived my own children and grandchildren, and never, never have I bowed to any man or woman. Not to mention dogs and cats, he added with a glance at Coyote and the Sphinxes. Coyote licked his teeth, and the Sphinxes stretched. It seems you have never met a coyote or a sphinx in your lifetime, Dampier said, while he put his left hand calmingly on Coyote's neck and his right on the back of the taller sphinx. They once tore a demon apart. It was not a pleasant sight. Even the conservators, who can resemble whole temples, couldn't bring them back. So why don't the two of us solve this in a fair fight, men against men? If I beat you, you follow the rules while you enjoy your hospitality. And when they pack the exhibit and send it back to Paris, you return to the library you haunted for 300 years. The Empress cast Dampier a worried look. Do you know what you're doing? Her dark eyes asked. What if he beats you, William Dampier? Louis sorted the curls of his dark brown wig not taking his eyes off Dampier. Back to the Bibliothèque Nationale. Now, all my life I didn't like books. And where do I end up as a ghost? In a library. A strange kind of punishment, isn't it? Did you like books in your lifetime? Yes, I did, Dampier replied. I even wrote some. Louis became a man again and stepped so close that the old pirate could feel his ghostly breath on his face. They had the same size, the pirate and the man who had called himself the Sun. So let's fight, Louis said. You seem to be very passionate about your rules. I'm passionate about this place, Dampier said. D'Artagnan stepped to his king's side. Baptiste was still under the bed. Now, your most Christian majesty, the musketeer whispered. This is a highly unreasonable method to conclude this argument. Let me do the fighting. Louis waved the musketeer's offer away like a fly. Unreasonable, bien! Shouldn't one have at least that advantage from being dead? All my life I had to give in to reason. No, Louis, you cannot dress yourself without servants. No, you cannot marry that woman although you love her. No, you can't go hunting. You have to meet the ambassador of Sweden, although he's the most boring man in Europe. I'm dead, for God's sake. Let me be unreasonable. And he drew his sword. It was a much better blade than the one Dampier carried, and William hadn't fought a proper sword fight since the ghost of a samurai had been brought to the Getty in a teapot. The Sun King was a good fencer, but he had learned to fight at court, and in war he had ordered his troops to attack and had rarely done any fighting himself. Most of the time he had just killed pheasants and stags on endless hunting trips. Dampier, in contrast, had learned to fence at the age of 12, and he had to do it to defend himself from savage sailors, pirates, and other professional murderers. Louis noticed his mistake very soon. He had been very proud of his dancing skills in his lifetime, but Dampier knew how to let a blade dance. He made his old sword sting like a wasp, snap like a viper, and cut off Louis's hands and arms several times, which is not very serious an injury for a ghost as their limbs melt together again quite fast. But Dampier also pierced Louis's pride each time he buried his blade in his ghostly flesh. There, off came his arm again, which had sealed so many death sentences. Off came the wig to reveal the graying short hair underneath, which even his mistresses hadn't laid eyes on too often. Ghosts don't bleed. There were only smears of light in the air around the two fighters, like the trails of a snail. And Louis looked older with every blow Dampier landed, until finally an old man dropped his sword, breathless and in pain from the gangrene that had once killed him. Dampier lowered his sword. You are a very good fighter, for a king, he added. But I guess I convinced you to accept the rules of this fortress. Louis stared at his feet, as if he just took a closer look at his high-heeled shoes. They had red heels. He had been very famous for the pride he took in the shoes. But Dampier knew that this time not his shoes, but exhaustion made him lower his head. The exhaustion of too long a life, both as a man and as a ghost. I'm so tired, the Sun King growled. Where are my armies? Where are my servants, my mistresses, my children and grandchildren? It's so utterly boring to be dead. Why doesn't it end? I just want to sleep. William Dampier picked up the sword that Louis had dropped and handed to him. Do you want me to guess? He asked. From one dead man to the other. I came to the conclusion, after having lived a ghost's life for 3 centuries, that for some of us, the duties don't end with death. In fact, they become more serious. Maybe because in life we didn't fulfill what we were meant to achieve. So, what I'm trying to say, maybe there's a task waiting for you at this fortress. Louis lifted his head. He looked a little younger again. Interesting, he said. Do you think we might celebrate that? I was not only famous for my conquests, I was also famous for my parties and for my fireworks. Though, he cast a glance at Changzhong, who was still surrounded by sparks. Even the best ones were nothing compared to her. The Emperor smiled and bowed so deep that her forehead touched her knees. She did know very well how to treat a king. So, where are we time-wise? Do we do one more question? Time questions? Five? Or 5 minutes? Okay. Do you have any questions left? Yes. I see one up there. Here, first.
Were any of your books like made into movies?
Seven.
Really?
And most of them I did not like very much. You know, and I like one very much, but that was the cheapest. It was a very small little movie made in Germany. There are two of them are in English, and one was a Hollywood movie. And I love to do the shooting. That was fantastic. The month in a village and meet my characters all running around me. That was fantastic. But when I saw the result, I was like, because you know what it feels like? It feels as if you do a flying carpet for 2 years, right? You do the weaving and it's really beautiful and big. And then you give it to the movies and they give you back a napkin. And they say, it's the same, Cornelia. And you say, no, it's not. And it doesn't fly very well. So at the moment, I'm a little careful with allowing movies.
Do you like all your books?
Except for one. I once did a sequel of a picture book long time ago because my publishers wanted it so badly. And I still think it is quite a boring story. So, but since then I've been strict, and every time I felt that story is not ready to be published, I did not publish it.
Did you keep a journal when you were little?
I did not. And it's interesting, I do, you know, by now I do that. You know, not a journal in a way, but more like a writer's journal about all the things I'm working on and I'm collecting. And as you see, I write all my stories into such notebooks. So I have more than 40 by now. And they're all in fireproof boxes because we're in LA.
In Inkheart, is the character... did you get the name of Eleanor from a real person?
No, I didn't. I made it up. And in German, it is der Natternkopf. So we thought a long time how we do it, but the Adderhead, I think, is a very beautiful translation. It's a very old word for snake. So Natter in German means snake. But it's the same as Dustfinger. His name is translated exactly like it is in German. Sometimes names are completely different. Thank you.
Hi, I'm a big fan of your Inkheart trilogy, and I just wanted to know who was the hero you connected with the most.
With Inkheart, that's really difficult because it's more like an ensemble piece. You know, when I say, oh, I love Dustfinger best, I think, oh no, I like Mo as well. Oh no, maybe I like Eleanor. Oh, I like Fenoglio because he's the writer. So with them, it's very hard for me, and I cannot really pick. And I'm currently writing short stories that are set a few years later, and I was very interested in whom I would go back to. And the first one who shows up is, of course, Orpheus, because he's a villain who escapes at the end, which I did not plan. I wanted to kill him, but he escaped. They do what they want. So, yes, So sadly, I cannot. You probably Dustfinger? Yes, everybody loves Dustfinger most. And the best explanation for that gave me a 9-year-old boy who said he makes his own rules.
What was your inspiration for Fenoglio?
Fenoglio, the name I took from a Ligurian writer who died very young, Beppe Fenoglio, who wrote brilliant, brilliant short stories about Liguria, northern Italy. And then I made him an old man, which Beppe Fenoglio never was. And I put everything in there that I know about writing. So Fenoglio is, in a way, me, though I don't get drunk when I'm writing, like he often does.
Okay, I think that might be the... So if you have more questions, you can ask Cornelia during the book signing.
Yes.
So, but before I make a few final announcements, let's thank Cornelia again. You are wonderful. You're wonderful. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
That was brilliant.
Well, thank you, and thank Louis Marquezano for bringing Louis XIV to the Getty. And I'll see you at the signing. Okay. Bye-bye.